Amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 24. This morning we're continuing our series on his resurrection and actually talking about that stone, that rock that was indeed rolled away. We began last week looking at this, and remember again, we talked about the death of Christ, and we went from the death of Christ right into speaking of his resurrection. Again, we're trying to look at it from the angle and understanding through the Pauline epistles, and what we basically said last week is that the Pauline epistles do not repeat any of the historical narratives. We serve a risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. But we began last week looking at some of those issues, the guarded tomb, the testimony really of the soldiers. This morning, we want to talk about the stone, and then we want to talk about the grave clothes. Luke chapter 24, verse 1. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the sepulcher bringing the spice which they had prepared, and certain others with them. Remember, the ladies, if you read the account, the end of Luke chapter 23, verses 50 to verse 56, they watched Joseph and Nicodemus. And reality is, they don't know that there are any soldiers guarding this tomb. They didn't even make plans. As they approach, the record of the Word of God says, well, who's going to roll away the stone that we can get in there and further anoint the body of Christ? So they prepared these spices. They were not looking for resurrection. Bringing the spice which they had prepared and certain others with them, and they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. Let's just look to the Lord in word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you. We thank you, God, for the word of God that we possess. And Lord, we just pray as we look to your word that you would help us to understand the truth of your word. We pray in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. So we want to begin this morning with the testimony of the stone. See, I had to smile as Scott had sung the song. I mean, he's wearing green, I'm wearing green. You might have thought we really planned this out. But the stone that was rolled away, and then as we were singing the hymn, one day the grave could conceal him no longer, one day the stone was rolled away from the door, then he arose. Well, we're going to show you that's not right. That's not the issue. Our foundation, our faith is dealing with the resurrection of Christ, the stone that was rolled away. But as we look to this, please understand, first of all, the stone that was rolled away was not rolled away by any humans, but it was moved by the angel of the Lord. Praise God. Then the moving of the stone. See, that hymn has it wrong. The moving of the stone was not to let Christ out. It was rather to let his disciples in to see that the body was missing. And then you've got to make some conclusions, and we'll talk about that. But it was to show literally, really, the grave clothes there, and then the empty tomb. As we look to this, there are specific words. Let's look back to Matthew. And then we'll give you an illustration, a diagram, literally. But Matthew chapter number 28, let's just read verse number 2. It was rolled back. Verse 1 says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. Verse 4 says, and for fear of him, the keepers, those guards, did shake and become as dead men. Remember, last week we told you that after Joseph of Arimathea begged and got permission from Pilate to bury the body of Christ, time is winding down. He had a 3-hour window of opportunity because the Sabbath is going to begin at 6 o'clock that night. And there were no guards there. The guards only came because the unbelieving Pharisees thought that his disciples would come sometime during the day in the next preceding days and steal his body, find someone else, and say, here is Christ risen. So he gets a Roman garrison, and they seal the tomb. It's now being protected by the power and the authority of the Roman Empire. If you would have been alive and you would have tried to do something at the stone, you would have received the wrath of those 16 soldiers. But now, we see that it was rolled back. Look over to Mark. Mark chapter 16, verse 4. And then we're just going to go then skip over to John and comment on John, because John uses a different word. Mark chapter 16, verse number 4. He sees you read verse 3. So the ladies come. Again, they watch what Joseph and Nicodemus did. For whatever reason, they made a determination that they were going to further anoint the body. Luke gives us the account of what they did. And that's why you'll ultimately understand that the only answer truly is a Wednesday crucifixion. But when they come this day, when they come, verse number 2 says, and very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came to the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. They didn't know there were Roman soldiers there. And they said among themselves, who shall roll away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? You see, they took all this time because they were going to further anoint the body of Christ, but they didn't even answer the basic question. How are you going to get in there? If this massive stone is blocking the entrance, how are you going to get in there? And then, of course, by this time, the resurrection took place and the guards left. And then verse number 4. So they're coming, and the point is, if you think about it, they're not looking for resurrection. You see, what some people will believe and say, that these disciples were so looking for resurrection that they had to look for any hope. No, they're defeated people. They're not looking and anticipating resurrection. So they come. Who's going to roll away the stone? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. It's massive. Look over to John chapter 20. Look over to John's account. Matthew, Mark, Luke speak of the stone being rolled back. John chapter 20, verse number 1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark unto the sepulchre, and seeth the what? What was it? It was taken. It was taken away from the sepulchre. The words for taken here, taken away, mean to lift up, to pick up, and to carry away. That's the force of the word. Let me put it this way. The stone was not just simply rolled a little distance from the opening of the sepulchre. It was moved, it was separated, it was taken away totally from the entrance of the sepulchre. Let me diagram it this way. And well, you understand, art is not my, forte, but I hope this at least helps you understand. Here's the entrance. You have to understand, somewhat imagination. That is the entrance to the tomb. Here's the stone. That's not what happened, right? It wasn't just slightly moved, so that these disciples then got on their hands and knees and crawled through it, through that little opening. In fact, one of the spiritual questions I really almost asked you to see how perceptive you were. I was going to put this picture on, which I did, the first screen and then the last screen, and ask you, what's wrong with this picture? The reality is, those stones are just simply even moved slightly. The entrance is now exposed, I will grant you that. But see, I don't even think that's the picture. If I go back to my diagram, and the reason why you see that little slope is because the reality is, if you go to the record of John and Luke and Matthew and Mark and look at what Joseph did and what Nicodemus did, there was only two guys. How'd they get that stone in front of the sepulchre to protect the body of Christ? Because there were grave robbers. I think there was a slight incline, so they were able to push it down. Here again, I think this is what happened. That's more of an accurate picture. It was taken up, it was picked up, and it was carried away. No humans did it. It was rather the angel of the Lord, and they did it not to let the body of Christ out. If you read that hymn again, it sounds like, well, the stones rolled away and then Christ arose. No, that's not accurate. That's not what happened. In fact, reality is, and what I'm going to put on the screen here is really based on a Wednesday crucifixion. And look back to Luke chapter 23 real quickly, because here you go. This is not the intent of the message this morning. It's rather to tell you, here we have the testimony of the guards, of the guarded tomb, the testimony of the stone that was not just rolled away, that it was literally picked up and moved. Luke chapter 23. And as you read verse number 50, you talk about Joseph of Arimathea. He's going to be the one that, again, was able to get the body from, beg Pilate for the body. And actually, I think one of your spiritual questions is, just think about it. Where are his disciples? Where are his disciples? It's two individuals, Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Verse 53, he took it down, he wrapped it in linen and laid in the sepulcher that was hewn in stone. That's what we're seeing. Wherein never man before was laid. And that day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew on. And the women also. Here you go. Here's the testimony of the women. And that's why when you read then in like Luke 24, Mark 16, they're coming in the early morning hours of Sunday, and their sole purpose, they didn't know that there had been Roman guards. Who's going to roll away the stone that we can go in there and further anoint the body? Because verse number 54 says, and the day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew on. And the women also, which came with him from Galilee, followed after, and they beheld the sepulcher. Oh, one of the false theories upon the resurrection of Christ is these people were so delirious, they just went to the wrong tomb. Seriously? But that's what people will believe. And they beheld the sepulcher. They made a mental note in how his body was laid. And they returned. You got to answer this question now for those who believe in a Friday crucifixion. And they returned and prepared spices and ointments and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. If you believe in a Friday crucifixion, the Sabbath day, folks, starts at 6 o'clock. They just got the body in before the Sabbath. And if the Sabbath is from Friday 6 p.m. to Saturday 6 p.m., how could they rest the Sabbath? How could they prepare spices, then rest the Sabbath? And even if you want to say that they did that, where did they get all these spices and ointments? By the way, they did not have a 24-hour convenience store back then, right? The point is, it's Wednesday. The Sabbath was sitting there on a Thursday because it was a high holy Sabbath. Then they could get the spices, do all that, and then still rest and celebrate the weekly Sabbath. And so based upon, and this is based upon a Wednesday crucifixion. You see, this is what I personally believe. I believe the scripture indicates this, but the Lord Jesus Christ was raised shortly after 6 p.m. on Saturday night. Jewish time is really Sunday. And the stone was not moved till Sunday. And the guards actually guarded an empty tomb that whole night. Think of irony of ironies. They're actually guarding an empty tomb. And the reason why the stone is rolled away was not to let the body of Christ out, but rather it was to let his disciples in and behold, number one, his grave clothes, and number two, the empty tomb. And then you have to make an understanding about that, and you will see what goes on. So you have the testimony of the stone. It's not just simply rolled a little bit to the right or to the left. And somehow his disciples got on their hands and knees and crawled around this just a little opening. Now I think John's account is That stone was picked up and totally and absolutely removed. Turn back with me to John chapter 20. And that does become the foundation of our belief, because the reality is, what do we believe? We believe that the Lord Jesus Christ died, he was buried, and that he rose, that he died. Not the swoon theory, well, you know, really, the Lord didn't die. Well, those guards who were doing the crucifixion knew he was dead. Rome was protecting that body from the 11 disciples, from anyone who would come to do anything. And remember what the words of the Pharisees. They didn't say, you know, you got to stay here for like a month, 2 months, 2 weeks, or a week. But this deceiver kept talking about the third day, the third day, the third day. And that's why the Roman guards were placed there. It was because of the callous, unbelieving heart of the Pharisees. And yet they become one of the great examples, testimonies to the resurrection of Christ. Testimony of the grave clothes. Now, we have to confess and understand. Because when we think upon this, and I know, not getting graphic, but we think, you know, shirt, suit, and tie. Lady in a dress. You understand that's not what they did back then. That's not the Jewish custom. The issue was that you wrapped the body. And that's why there were, as you read the account, it's over, Joseph and Nicodemus had over 100 pounds of spices and ointments that they put on the body of Christ. Look at John's account. The first day of the week, cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone, not just rolled away, but as we said, taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter, the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and that's John, and saith unto them, what? They have taken. Even at this point, they don't even conceive of resurrection. They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre. The Pharisees wouldn't have done it, because if they just took the body out to steal it, what would they have done? They would have marched that body of Christ through Jerusalem and say, these guys are a bunch of liars. Rome wouldn't have cared. Rome didn't want to get caught up in this. But they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they've laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and another disciple, and they came to the sepulchre. And they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes. You don't see this in the original language, but if you have a Strong's Concordance, check this out. In verse 5, John saw something. He, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and he went into the sepulchre, and he seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also the other disciple, which came first to the sepulchre, and he, what? Saw and believed. You don't see it in the original language. There are three, it's amazing, there are three different words here in the original language for the word saw. Translated, saw, seeth, and saw. Let me explain it this way. The first one in John 20, verse 5, is speaking of, again, if you have it in front of you, and he's stooping in, looking, saw the linen clothes lying, yet he went not in. It's speaking of John. What does that mean? John had a glance, a quick look, but he didn't go in. That's the first word. Then Simon Peter had been following him as they ran to the sepulchre. And then in verse number 6, he looks in, he seeth the linen clothes. This word means to look at, to take a view at. He's looking a little bit longer than just a mere glance. But now John goes into the sepulchre. And we'll comment on this in a few moments, but he sees the linen clothes and the napkin not lying together, but wrapped together in a place by itself. And when he comes in, when John sees this, John enters now, and he saw and believed. And the third word, saw, or foresee, implies not just a mere looking, not just like a glance, which the first one refers to John, but an actual perception. It means to understand, it means to perceive, it means to see with the mind. Do you see the difference? The first time he kind of just looked in. I mean, we're all guilty of this. You're driving down the street and there's something, you know, for us who live out where off of Scotch Valley and things, you're looking for deer at night. You know they're there. You don't know when they're coming, but you know they're there. So you might just take a quick glance. Or maybe if you're driving through the country, driving through the city, there's something that draws your attention and you just kind of take a quick glance. That's the first word. Last word, see, is to perceive and understand with the mind. It's more than just taking a quick glance. It'd be like driving, and you wouldn't want to do this. Obviously, you're driving down, your attention is drawn, and you're just fixated on something, and then you understand. That's the third word. He saw with his mind. And the reality is, there should be the word more there. Peter saw more after he entered into the tomb than John at his first glance. If you compare what John just glances into the tomb. Peter, when he goes in, he saw more than John did. But John saw more into the meaning of the grave clothes. Peter had more physical sight, as it were, but John had more spiritual insight to what this meant. John believed without seeing the Lord, and Peter left the sepulchre still wondering. One man made the comment, and I just so strongly disagree with this, that what John saw and believed, he just believed what the witness of Mary had said earlier, that they took the body of the Lord away from the sepulcher. He saw it and he believed her words. Well, we're going to show you. I think that's wrong. I think what he saw had such an impact on his mind. He saw, and he saw with this great understanding. It all now comes to light. Peter does leave still wondering. At first, if you read the account of Luke, in fact, look back to Luke 24 for a moment and read Luke's account. Again, with the ladies, dealing with the fact that they had come and the body of Christ is not there. Angel is going to say, why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here, but he is risen. You read in verse number 11 of the ladies, and it goes on at the end of verse 10, in which told these things to the apostles. In their words seemed to them, the apostles, as what? Idle tales. Idle tales is the only time it appears here in the Word of God, New Testament. It means foolish talk. It means nonsense. At first, it just seemed like idle tales. It seemed like foolish talk. It seemed like absolutely nonsense. Go back, if you'll turn back to John. And the reality is, we can show you the verse of Scripture in Mark and in Luke, that Christ was talking, and he says that I'm going to be delivered, I'm going to be crucified, but I'll be raised the third day. And they were afraid to ask him these things. So these apostles were not, you know, so mind, you know, had their minds so set on resurrection that they had to, no, it seemed like foolishness. It seemed like idle talk. It seemed like nonsense to them. But when John sees what he saw, he just didn't believe the lady's words that the body's missing. I think it means when he saw, he believed. He now knew. He saw with his mind. He perceived with his mind that the Lord Jesus Christ
was resurrected. And so he believed without seeing the Lord. Peter leaves a sepulcher. John saw the grave clothes, the linen clothes, and the separate piece wrapped around his head, undisturbed in their original form. There's only a couple things, there's only a couple ways to answer this, right? If the body is missing, what should also be missing? The grave clothes. Oh, you got to remember, if his disciples came by night or somehow, you know, sometime during the hours of Saturday, they would have been met with 16 of Rome's finest military machine. To somehow believe and to think that those 11 disciples who are nowhere to be found, didn't even bury the body of Christ, came and outwitted 16 of Rome's finest men because they slept, moved a, and you saw the massive size, I mean, the pictures we showed you, I don't even think, help us understand the massive size of that stone, weighing anywhere from a half a ton to a ton. Moved it. We got to be real quiet. We don't want to disturb the 16 Roman soldiers who, you know, they're derelict in their duty. They're going to be dead men. Walked in. If they stole the body, the grave clothes are gone. And then it should have been empty. If they decided to steal the body and leave the grave clothes back, what condition would you expect to find the grave clothes? A messed up. How could they have, and the Jews, when they did the body preparation, they would have wrapped the arms and the legs separately. I mean, in our mind, we're going to talk about Lazarus, so we've got to move along here. As a mummy, but they would have wrapped them individually. Could you imagine them unwinding this? Oh, now we have to rewind it. No, and that's what John saw. And if you look back to John chapter 20, he believed. And then someone would say, well, verse 9 says, for as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Yeah. They did not go anticipating resurrection, but when John saw those grave clothes wrapped together, undisturbed, inside the sepulcher, there was not a chaotic picture. It was a picture of absolute order and complete order. The body was gone, but the grave clothes were in perfect form as a shell or a cocoon, because the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was resurrected, what did he do? He passed through those grave clothes. The angel of the Lord didn't come down and have to unwind them. He walked straight through and left them as a shell, or if you want, a cocoon. And we've already talked about this, but if the body had been stolen, the grave clothes would have been stolen or scattered all over the inside of the sepulcher. The only explanation. That's why it becomes the cornerstone of the Christian faith is what? The resurrection, not just the bodily resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look back to John chapter 11. My point is, as we look at this, and I understand, you know, Resurrection Sunday is still weeks away. But as we look at this, these last 2 weeks have just laid down what really took place historically, but are going to move and show you the importance of the resurrection as it's tied into our Christian faith based on the Pauline epistles. And Paul doesn't go through all this. He does mention in 1 Corinthians 15 some of the post-resurrection appearances of Christ. But just think about the bodily resurrection of Christ versus Lazarus. The Lord came, and of course, Lazarus had died, and the Lord could have healed Lazarus long distance. The Lord could have gotten here earlier before Lazarus died. But it had been some time, and he's going to tell Martha upon the issue and Mary upon the issue of resurrection. And the Lord even says in verse 39, you take away the stone, because what he is going to do is to the glory of God. And they don't understand and realize the Lord Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. And look as you begin reading here. Well, verse 42, I knew that thou hearest me always, but because the people which stand by, I said that they may believe that thou hast sent me. He's praying to God, God the Father. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. He cried, Lazarus, you come forth. Because if he would have just said, come forth, what would have happened? Anyone who had died up to that time would have been walking around. So he says, Lazarus, I want you, and I want you to come forth. And he that was dead came forth, responded, showing obviously this is the glory of God. But he came forth what? What? Bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face, we'll talk about this in a moment, was bound about with a napkin, and Jesus said unto them, what? Do you see the difference? When the Lord Jesus cried, it was a great miracle, but when he raised Lazarus from the dead, what does he have to do? He has to get some of those people there. I mean, they had to be in shock, and they had to unwind him, loose him, and let him go. I want you to picture and understand when the Lord Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, there's no one doing that. There's no angel that's going to do that, because then his grave clothes would have been in a chaotic state. But they were absolutely perfect. Look back to John 20. That's what I believe that John sees. And you say, well, if Peter was there and the other ladies walked in, why didn't they see that and believe? How come some people believe and when they hear the gospel, and some people take 5-10 years to believe? How come some people never want to respond to the gospel? How come some believers, when they respond, understand, and want to give their life for the Lord, and others, the issue is everyone is different. But I believe as you read the account here, it's not just that he saw and he believed what the words of the ladies were, like his body was taken, and we don't know what's going on. I think he absolutely believed because the shell of those linen clothes were intact, and the body was not there. And notice in verse number 7, again, what Simon Peter went in, he seeth the linen clothes, because he's not seeing with his mind here. And the napkin that was wrapped around his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. What does that tell you? It tells you that they wrapped the body and they wrapped the head separately, correct? You only have a few minutes. This is the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? Amen, right? What does it tell you? It tells you that there's at least two different things that they use, right? One for the head and one for the body. Thank you. Because then I can put this on the screen. I'm only going to put partial. You ever hear the Shroud of Turin? And they argue whether this is a grave clothes of the Lord Jesus Christ and this is only a headshot. And they go all bananas and say, well, this is the Lord Jesus Christ and there's a full body. Time out. How can it be? It shows part of the body, but what's the issue? The issue with this is it's one piece. The issue in John 20 is very clear. The issue in John 20 is that Simon Peter, following him, went to the sepulcher. He sees the linen clothes lie and the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Why people worry about this? It's beyond me. Because today in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we walk by what? Faith and not by, I don't need this. I don't need people to say, well, carbon dating and it kind of proves and oh man, you know. No. Look what God did even with the original Ten Commandments as Moses destroyed them because of coming out of the mountain, what was going on. We don't need original things. We have an inspired, inerrant, infallible word of God. And I just bring that up because the issue is, there's at least two separate, and they're wrapped together. What, he wrapped around the body, and they wrapped around the head. And the stone, and so the spiritual application, obviously, is what? The bodily resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's just pray. Dear God, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for all that you mean to us. Continue to lead, guide, and direct in Christ Jesus' name.